You have your Bibles, please. We are in the book of John this morning, the 7th chapter. John chapter 7 will begin at verse number 6. And we will go to the 16th verse. John chapter 14, verse 5 to 16. John chapter 14. And Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? And Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. If ye have known me, you should have known my Father also, and from henceforth ye know him and have seen him. And Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it will be sufficient. And Jesus said unto him, Have I been so long with time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that has seen me hath seen the Father, and how sayest thou, then show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? For the words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that is in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very works' sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. We can stop right there, George. Father, we thank you for your word. I pray your word would truly go forth in not only power, Lord, but that your word would speak life to us today. Draw us to your presence. Help us to understand. Quicken our hearts and our minds and draw us deeper with you, Father. We give you the praise and we give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. I've simply entitled this message, Greater Works with a question mark. Greater Works. Now, Jesus says that those who believe will be able to do not only great works, but even greater works. And that has really opened the door to a lot of discussion, perhaps even controversy. What does this mean? Is Jesus telling us that we can do greater works than he did? Is this what the Bible is teaching this morning? Well, as we begin by way of introduction, we know that the real test of the Holy Spirit in you is not so much in church. It's not so much what goes on here in our assembly Sunday morning, although there's certainly a part to do with that, but that's not where the Holy Spirit is operating primarily. The Holy Spirit is supposed to operate primarily in your life. What you do next day, what you do at work, what's going on in your home life, what you do with your friends and neighbors, what you do behind closed doors. That's really an indication of how the Holy Spirit is working in your life. Because a lot of us can look very churchy Sunday morning. Nothing wrong with looking churchy. I like churchy looks, as long as it's not too churchy, if you know what I mean. But who you really are takes place when you leave this place. When you go to works Monday morning at 9 o'clock, when you're late and your boss tries to tell you off a little bit, how are you going to react? How are you going to respond? See, that's where real life, that's what it's all about. When you come home and you see your child has done something wrong, maybe that your child has skipped school, gone away for a weekend, didn't tell you when they're going to come back. And all of a sudden you discover they come home and they don't look very good. See, that's how you know whether the Holy Spirit is working in your life, how you respond to things, how you respond to daily action, daily affairs, how you respond to the circumstances in life. That's an indication of how the Holy Spirit is working in your life. And now Jesus in our text is giving his final address to his disciples. He has a word for his disciples, and in this text, it's a final address. And we need to pay attention when Jesus gives his word at any address, but when it's a final address, we better listen very carefully. And in the midst of this, his disciples are asking some questions to Jesus, particularly Thomas. He wants to know about the future. He wants to know about eternity. Jesus responds to him, and then he asks further questions, and Jesus looks at him and says, Thomas, you've asked me to show me your Father. All right, you want to see the Father. Thomas, I've been with you for a long time. Just show us the Father you ask. And Jesus says, Philip, Thomas, he says to them all, you've already seen the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. What is Jesus saying? He's saying, look, Thomas, Philip, Peter, I and the Father are one, John chapter 10, verse 30. The word one in the Greek means the same substance. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. We're together. We're one. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, we're all one. You see, Philip, when I raise the dead, when I heal the sick, the lame and the blind, when I fed the thousands, that was the Father in me, Philip. That was the Father in me, Thomas. That was his power through my life. Because we're one. Jesus says, Philip, you need to understand that he that has seen me has seen the Father also. And the point is that Jesus is saying is that the same element of the Father through me, he's saying now to his disciples, just as I was not alone, that my Father was with me, so it is with you, my disciples. Wherever you go, I will be working through you. I will be with you. So just as the Father was with me and allowed me to do all these miracles because we're one, it's the same power, so it will be with you. As you are being dispersed throughout the land, doing my work, you will not be orphaned. You will not go alone. You will have my presence with you, my power with you. For lo, I am with you to the very ends of the earth, Matthew 28 tells us. I will never leave you nor forsake you. And so the key, now watch this, the key that Jesus is saying, the secret of these words is not in my physical presence, but when I am gone. When I leave this earth, my disciples, I'm going to send you my comforter. I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit that will empower you, that will fill you, that will strengthen you, that will guide you. And that's where we get verse number 12, George. Can we see verse number 12? Verily, verily, I say unto you that he that believes on me, the Greek word for believe is the word pistevo. Pistevo in the Greek has a threefold message. It means to believe with your heart, your mind, and your soul. I repeat, your heart, your mind, and your soul. Brothers and sisters, if we started believing with all of our heart, our minds, and our souls, what kind of believers would we be? Pretty powerful. Many of us believe, but some of us believe only with our heads. But if we have that threefold pistevo, that threefold belief, we believe with everything within us, what difference would there be? Can you imagine how you would live this life? He that believeth, pistevo, mind, soul, heart, the works that I do shall he do also. And here's the controversy. Uh-oh. Here's a tough one. Greater works too, Lord? You're telling me... But I'm still trying to understand, Lord, being able to do the works that you did, but now you're really messing me up. Now you're telling me I can even do greater works? Am I reading this properly? Is this what Jesus is saying, or is he kind of trying to, for lack of a better term, trying to pump me up a little bit? Or is this what he's, what is really going on? And so, because this is very intriguing to me, and been a source of controversy for many years with many believers. I've decided to dissect this and give you three P's as we look into the text. And I'm going to give you three P's, and the first point I want to make this morning, number one, I want you to notice the possibility of greater works. Jesus says greater works you can do. So what does this mean? Now, during Jesus' ministry, he casted out demons, he walked on water, he healed the sick, but how can this be related to us? Can we do the very same things that Jesus did? Someone will come to you and say, yes, of course you can, brother. Absolutely you can. Just have faith to believe. So if you have faith, you will no doubt have people who are blind, they'll see. If you have faith, you will see the dead raised. You'll be able to walk on everything that Jesus did, even greater. You'll be able to do them if you have the faith to believe. That's what some people say. Ah, okay. I believe that. Doesn't the Bible say that faith without works is dead? Doesn't the Bible say that the faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things that are not seen, that we cannot please Him without faith? Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, verse 6 as well. But I need to park the car and I've got to pause for a moment because I believe that, but something's a little off here. I gotta think about this. What does this mean? I've got to pause because the problem is if our ability to see these greater works is dependent upon my faith and your faith, so far so good. I kind of can receive that. But if our ability to see these greater works is dependent upon my faith, then your faith and my faith must be greater than Jesus' faith, if I'm to see greater works. Are you telling me, Pastor, that I can have greater faith than Jesus? Am I to believe that? Like some people would have us believe? When I got saved, I went to a church that believed that. They told me, Dino, you've got to have the God kind of faith. The God kind of faith. Okay. I didn't fully grasp what that meant because I'm just a human being. Well, they told me, if you can believe even more than Jesus believed, then you're going to see greater works. I said, oh, so I've got to believe more than Jesus to see these works. And that's what constitutes these greater works. I have a problem. If our ability to see these greater works is dependent upon our faith and our faith alone, then our faith must be greater than Jesus' faith. But friends, that's impossible. Can I be real for a moment? We just had a miracle here. I believe that Martin's faith, people's faith, I believe that he prayed, and by faith, God touched him and he was healed. I believe that with all my heart. But that's not what I'm talking about this morning. I'm talking about, what does verse 12 say? That if I believe the works that Jesus did, I can do, but and even greater works than Jesus. Is this dealing with miracles and healings and raising of the dead? What does this mean? Some people believe that you must have greater faith than Jesus to see all these things take place. But what is Jesus saying? Is Jesus saying you can have greater faith than God can have? Is the Bible saying I can have greater faith than God Himself? Do we actually believe that? Like some people preach? The answer is emphatically, without any doubt, hesitation, or apprehension, a big fat N-O. That is ridiculous. That's blasphemy to think that I can have greater faith than Jesus. And if there's anybody here who thinks that, I got a counseling session with you after the service, please. That's not what the Bible is teaching. What is the Bible teaching about greater faith or greater works? Well, I'm glad you asked because you're in the right place. Now, before someone says, uh-oh, Pastor Dino's against having faith. I just said, no, we need faith. I believe Martin got healed because of faith. That's not what I'm talking about this morning. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Thank you so much. What do the greater works mean? What is this all about? Well, watch this now. Every person who was healed by a miracle. We know that. We see that in the scriptures. But they eventually died. Can I hear an amen? Lazarus, for example, died twice. He did. Jesus raised him from the dead. Then he died again. All of these miracles that Jesus did were to draw people to God for the purpose of what? The purpose of salvation. There's the key word. Stay with me. Jesus' mission was what? To seek and save the lost. Luke chapter 19. To bring people from physical death into spiritual life. Can I hear an amen this morning? You see, this will help us understand what Jesus is saying. What is the possibility? You see, the possibility of these greater works, watch this now, and I'm going to explain it, is in the realm of salvation. If we think we can do greater works physically than Jesus did, we have a real problem. We have what I call a Messiah complex. So, folks, I'm sorry to say to you, you can't do greater works than Jesus. Sorry to disappoint you. You can't do it. It will never happen. Because you're not God. God can use you and God can bless you, yeah. But if you think, like some of these false teachers think, that you can go around doing greater works than Jesus because you've got this tremendous faith that puts you on a higher level than Jesus, we have some serious problems. Serious ones. The possibility of these greater works has to be referring to something else. Oh, by the way, in passing, have you heard anybody who walked on water lately? I believe it's very possible, but do you know any? Do you know any? Have you heard of any recent story that maybe you have? What are these greater works? What is Jesus referring to? It cannot mean the works that he did on earth only, that I can do greater works than that. It's got to mean something else. Oh, I've seen people healed. We've seen many people healed. But this is not what the Bible is talking about. So we see the possibility of these greater works. But then notice number two, the promise of the Father. I'm going to explain all this, so just stay with me. This message is to perk something in your mind this morning. Notice now the promise of the Father, verse 12. Because I go to the Father, verse 12 says, watch this now, George, give it to me. Verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also, and greater works than these. Why? Because I'm going to my Father. Oh, so all of these works is possible because I'm going to my Father, the promise of the Father. Jesus is saying these miracles, these greater works will come after I go to my Father. Jesus is saying there's something God wants to do, but not until I go away, not until I ascend to the Father. In John 16, Jesus says, I'm going to send you my comforter. The Greek word for comforter is parakletos, or which means a paraclete in the English, which means a comforter. How did this paraclete come about? During the time of Alexander the Great, the great Greek general, when he conquered most of the world, what would happen in one of his major strategies and why he was so successful is he had paracletes. What are paracletes? Paracletes were on the field, when someone got hurt badly, someone maybe on the battlefield was bleeding, maybe bleeding to death, maybe somebody on the battlefield had a sword and maybe cut his arm, and who knows what was happening. And they found out that somebody is dying on the field, he would send these nurses or these doctors, and he would send them. It was the only army on the face of the earth that did this, that while the battle was going on, he would send these paracletes, these nurses, these doctors to go and rescue them and risk their lives and bring healing to them while they were bleeding. Paracletes. To help them. And sometimes they'd bring them back and rescue them, bandage them up, and walk them back. This is while the battle was going on, risk their lives and bring them back to camp so they can heal. paraclete. So with that in mind, it will help us understand what the Holy Spirit is supposed to do in your life and in my life. He is a comforter when you're hurting in battle. Amen. When you're bleeding and you've got no one to turn to, He's there to lift you up. When you're in battle and the enemy has scarred you and someone has forsaken you and maybe you've lost some hope or some dignity, there's someone there you can turn to. It's the paraclete of God, the Holy Spirit, who's come to comfort you and strengthen you. But this can happen, Jesus says, only after I go to my Father. To my Father. And in John chapter 7, verse 38 and 39, Jesus is preaching during the Passover season, the time we are in right now. He gives an address. And Jesus says that the Holy Spirit will come after I am glorified, after I die and I am resurrected, the Holy Spirit will come. You see, we won't be able to receive the Holy Spirit until this incredible event takes place. And that's why Jesus told his disciples in Luke chapter 24, he turns to them and says, you must wait for the what? The promise of the Father. What promise? Promise of the Holy Spirit. They didn't fully understand what the Holy Spirit was all about. They just knew that God promised them something, and by faith they went into this upper room and they were praying and they were waiting on God. Can you imagine? You're not sure what the Holy Spirit is all about, but you just obey the voice of the Lord. They don't fully understand these things. A lot of the disciples, listen folks, don't think the disciples were great supermen of faith. A lot of them had no idea what was going on half the time. Especially Peter. No, I'm serious. Now, before we get down on Peter, he was still the first man that walked on water, by the way. So let's just... okay, having fun. But that's the truth. And so here it is. So you obey me. I'm going to obey my Lord. He tells me about this promise. And so they're waiting in this upper room, Acts chapter 2. They're not so sure what's going on. And they're praying. And there's the key word. They're praying and they're waiting. And all of a sudden, when they least expected, the Holy Spirit came and empowered them. And they were changed. And they received an experience that they've never experienced before. But all of this took place after Jesus ascended. This is extremely important. After he ascended, 50 days later, after Jesus went to be with his Father, the Holy Spirit fell. Acts chapter 1, and ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. He's giving his address in chapter 1 of Acts, telling his disciples he's going to leave. But when I leave, the Holy Spirit will come upon, the paraclete of God will come upon you, and you will receive power. The Greek word for power is dynama, dynamite. You'll receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. What kind of power are you talking about? Am I getting into greater works? Yes, you are. Hang on to your hats. It's coming now. Watch this. In Acts chapter 3, in one day, Peter the apostle, who was a bumbling, fumbling, denying disciple, receives the power of the Holy Ghost. And in one day, Peter is preaching. And in one day, he's preaching so powerfully with signs and wonders. 3,000 souls got saved in one day. That's more than Jesus won to himself in his entire 3-year ministry. You see, that's the greater works. Yes. Do you understand? Yes. Don't be foolish to think that my greater works is I can go now and raise 20 dead people from the coffins. That's not the greater works. The greater works is much more deeper and much more powerful. Keep hanging on to your hats. We're going to get there in a few moments. Hold on. One day, 3,000 souls. When did that happen? After Jesus ascended. The point, there were more souls saved in one day than the entire 3 years ministry of Jesus, as I mentioned. You see, my brothers and my sister, the greater works that Jesus is speaking about, no doubt, is in the area of salvation, of winning the lost, something we haven't done very well lately. Don't let me preach on this either. Why do you think the Bible says that heaven rejoices. The angels rejoice when one soul gets saved. Thousands of angels are rejoicing. Why doesn't the Bible say thousands of angels are rejoicing when someone gets healed? Nothing. Listen, I believe in healing. Please don't send me letters. I prayed for people who got healed. But the point is, the angels rejoice, thousands of them, when one sinner comes to know Christ. Because salvation is what brings rejoicing in heaven, because of this was the mission of Jesus Christ. Amen. To seek and save the lost. That's his mission. Because salvation is the greater work. In Luke chapter 10, the disciples said, even the demons are subject to us, Jesus. And they're all getting excited. The demons are subject to us. There's some people that like the fact that they've got authority over demons. Okay, wonderful. The demons submit to you. But Jesus said, hold on a second now. Don't rejoice in this so much. But rejoice that your names are written down in heaven, in glory. In other words, rejoice that you're saved. Rejoice of the more important things. Not that demons submit to you, but that your name is written down in glory. Don't you love that hymn? Can you know the first verse? There's a new name written down in
glory, and it's mine. Oh yes, it's mine. And the wide robed angels tell the story.
A sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. And it's forgiven. I am for heaven. You see, do you understand? That's what angels get excited about. That's what Jesus gets excited about. And by the way, I'm going to tell you, that's what gets me excited too. Do you remember when you first got saved?
Yes.
Do you remember that? Some of us old folks like me, do you forget how excited you used to get when you brought someone to Christ? Have you forgotten maybe? Maybe we've become a little stale? Huh? Have we forgotten? Do you remember when you first got saved? What you wanted to do with your friends and your neighbors? Got to tell them about Jesus. You see, you didn't want to tell them about, you got to tell them about, because you got saved. There's something about salvation. Something about the greater works. That's what you sing about. You see, conversion is the greatest work because it lasts forever. And that's why, brothers and sisters, when we talk about sharing the love of Christ with people, that's why there's nothing more important than doing that. Do you know that evangelism is the Alpha and Omega of Christianity? It's the very purpose of the cross. If you've lost your burden for the lost, if you don't care for sinners, if you don't care for people, if you don't care for your neighbors who don't know God, if you don't care for that person that works with you, that doesn't, if you don't care for the lost, something isn't right with your heart.
Amen.
Because that person at work that doesn't know Jesus is the very person that Jesus died for.
Amen.
And who is to say, sir, that God doesn't want to use you to bring that person to Christ?
Yes.
He's not going to use me. I'm over here. Pastor can't do very much. But he can use you. He can use you. Hey, Frank, by the way, he can also use you. I know it's hard to imagine. But I love this man. He can use all of us. He can use all of us. That's why the church is so important. Not this church. This is not the church. This is just a building. Brick, and this is not the church. You are the church. Don't get too excited about this building. I don't care about this building. We do need to fix it once in a while, though, so I do care a little bit. Sorry, I got to be honest. Oh, by the way, we do have a leaky roof. I'm having fun. But the point is, it's not about this building. It's not about this building. It's not about the carpets. We get so caught up on these non-issues. Pastor, the carpet needs to be changed. Why? Well, we need to spend money to, you know, the carpet doesn't, you know, we're in the house of God here. I know that. And we lose our focus. We think that all these external things are more important than ministering to people's needs. Ministering to people who need to be touched. People who don't have anything. Well, we lose focus on the externals. And we lose focus and we get so caught up on these non-issues, these external matters, when Jesus was concerned about internal matters. Now, that doesn't mean we leave the ship to run aground. Doesn't mean we're going to let the building collapse. No, of course not. It's all about perspective, isn't it? Your perspective means everything. Doesn't it mean everything? How you view things. You know, 1 minute, I just had a thought, but 1 minute in life isn't very long, is it? 1 minute, isn't it? It's not too bad. In light of eternity, is a minute long? Are you kidding me? But for some of us athletes, and maybe non-athletes, a minute might be an eternity if you're on a treadmill. And you got to run for a minute on that treadmill. And it's on fast. And you got to keep up that treadmill. You see, that minute to somebody might not mean very much. But to you who haven't run in 30 years, that can mean an eternity. You understand? Perspective. Perspective. How do you see things? How do you see that lost person that's your neighbor? Do you see him as important? Do you see him as God sees him? How do you see them? The Bible says, he that winneth souls is?
Wise.
He that winneth souls is?
Wise.
If you care for people, you are wise. If you care for the lost, you have the ultimate of wisdom, Sophia. You see, salvation is the one thing that will change a person entirely. If any man be in Christ, if any man be in Christ, if you are born again, I talked about these three sermons the Lord just gave me. These three sermons about the new wine, being born again, and this one here. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things have passed away. There's something that's changed. You've experienced something that's transformed your life. You see, this will turn you loose for what you and I have been created for, and that's to touch people's lives. Do you think you were created to come to this church and sit down in this pew? I'm glad you're here, but it's not about coming to church Sunday morning and listening to the pastor. It's good that you do. I'm very grateful, trust me. But it's not about that. It's what you do once you leave this place, you see. That's what matters. The food that you've been receiving, the life that's been touching you, what you're doing with what you're experiencing, maybe in this place, translated into the world in which you live in. That's what it's all about. It's not about the physical. Do we care for people? Do we have a burden for the lost? Have we become so spiritually sophisticated we don't care anymore? Because I'm going to heaven, that's all that matters. A young boy, 12-year-old boy, one day in California coast, was picking up what somebody thought were rocks and just throwing them into the ocean. And a man was observing him. He was about 30, 40 feet away, but he couldn't see properly because of the glare of the sun. And as he changed his position, he noticed that this boy was picking up these starfish. Myriads of starfish just beached on the coast in some place in California. I forget where it was. True story. And he's picking up, he thought they were rocks, and throwing them back into the water. For I don't know how long he was doing it. So finally the man went down and said, "Excuse me, young man. Well, why are you picking up these starfish and all, like you've been doing it, if I've been noticing you for the last half hour, you're picking up these, and you're just throwing them into the water. What difference? Why is this? There's too many of them. Why are you doing this? Does it really make a difference? He said. Does it really make a difference? The boy looked at the man. He bent down. He took a starfish and he showed him. He threw him back into the water. And he said, "Sir, for that starfish, it meant all the difference in the world." You see, man counts by thousands, but God counts by ones. He cares for you. He cares for your neighbor. He cares for the hurting at your work where nobody cares. He cares for that abused person that nobody wants to talk to. And guess who he uses to minister his love? You. It's you. That's what your calling is. This is this whole purpose of this message. We think somehow that the evangelist has got to do it, and the pastor, and all these big names. That's the furthest from the truth. Our mission is the same mission as Jesus. If Jesus has touched your heart, his mission becomes yours. And what is that? To seek and save. To touch lives. To bless. To make a difference in this world. To pick up starfish that nobody cares about and throw them back into the water. This is your calling. This is the calling for this church, Logos. We're not called to be keepers of aquariums. We're called to be fishers of men. And that's what Jesus told Peter. This is what he told Peter. This is what he's telling the church. You see, during Jesus' ministry, only a few were saved. The focus was on the entire 12 disciples. He focused on the disciples. He spent time with them and he nurtured them. Why? So they can reproduce themselves in the lives of other people. Why? So they can reproduce themselves in the lives of other people. Why? So they can reproduce themselves in the lives of other people. Isn't this what Paul said in 1 Corinthians, I believe 11 chapter, says, "Imitate me as I imitate Christ." Imitate me as I imitate Christ. The word imitate is a Greek word, mimios, which comes the English word mimeograph, which evolved to the word photocopier. Jesus is saying, I want you to be a photo. I want you to produce others. I want you to make photocopies of yourself in the lives of others. That's what it means in the Greek. Imitate. Mimios. Mimic. Mimeograph. Photocopier. We are to what? Bring people to Christ to reproduce ourselves in them. That is what Paul is saying. That is what Jesus is saying. Go and make disciples of men. Amen. Now I know we're growing, but is this what it's all about? No. It's much deeper than that. Much deeper. Much deeper. You see, when Jesus went to heaven, he left the message of Christianity in the hands of the 12 disciples to spread the word to us today, to the year 2017, right now, in the month of April, just before Easter. The message still applies. And watch this now. And the Holy Spirit is the fuel. The Holy Spirit is the fuel to help us do that very job, if you will, or to do what he's called us to do. And it's the fuel. Ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. That's the fuel. We learned in Ezekiel, I shared a message where the water was rising in Ezekiel's temple from the ankles to the knees to the waist and to over the head, and they were able to swim in this water. Again, that's a picture of the Holy Spirit. And as you keep reading Ezekiel chapter 47, you'll find out that this water brought healing to the land. You are to bring healing. You are to bring. We talked about the living water that Jesus spoke when he met that woman that was thirsty. And Jesus said, if you drink that water in the well, you're going to thirst again. But if you drink the water I give you, you'll never thirst again. It's a living water. And out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. That's the infillment of the Holy Spirit. That's what gives you the power to do the things that you can't do in your own strength. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. So we talked about being born again. We talked about the witnesses. We talked about Ezekiel's temple. We talked about the living water. We talked about the new skins. You can't receive new wine in old wineskins. Your wineskins need to be changed in order to receive the new wine. The new wine, again, is a picture of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, I'm sending you a comforter, a paracletos. I'm sending you that you will have not only comfort, but you'll receive power to do what I've called you to do. You don't have to go to seminary to know what God's called you to do. You don't have to go to some mission class or some kind of class that the church gives you. I'll tell you what you're called to do. You're called to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. You're called to reproduce yourself and other people. Imitate me as I imitate Christ, Paul said. Mimeograph. Be a photocopier. Be that example in the lives of others that they will follow your example. Let me ask you, do people follow your example? Do people follow your example? That's what God's calling you to do, to be the salt of the earth, to be the light of the world. That's what these greater works are all about. These greater works is bringing people to God, encouraging people. You know, after Jesus ascended, after the day of Pentecost, millions of people got saved till today. The point is, this is the greater works. We've got television, internet, radio. We can reach thousands of people. Jesus only reached a few. These are the greater works. Not raising the dead. Be nice if a few people raised from the dead, wouldn't it? But that's not the greater works. When I was in India, I preached a campaign. 400 souls got saved. 400 souls. We've erected 7 brand new churches. 400 souls. People were touched, they were even healed, but it was the salvation, and they got baptized, and I baptized most of them in the Ganges. I couldn't, because I had to leave. I'm in the Ganges. 100. How can that be possible? Because Jesus said, greater works. Jesus never won 400 souls in one sitting to Christ, to himself. Do you see what I'm trying to say? That's your calling, brother and sister. I don't have to come to the pastor. I got an appointment with you, pastor. I want to know what God's called me to do. Listen, if you don't know by now, I might have a word for you, but if you don't know by now, then... But can I tell you what God's called you to do? He's called you to reproduce yourself in other people's lives. That's what he's called you. Moms, to touch your children. To let them see Jesus. Dads, to be good to your wife. Let them see Jesus. To love one another, to bless one another. Let Jesus be seen in your life as your calling and my calling. Don't get too crazy. Oh, God wants to use you where you're at. He wants to use you. If you're waiting for this great opportunity down the road, it could come, but what about now? What is God calling you to do now? To reproduce yourself in the lives of others. That's what he's called you. That's the greater works. Number 3, my last point. Notice now the power of the greater works. John 14, verse 12, George. The power of these greater works. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believes on me, the works that I do, ye shall do also, and greater works than these. Go to my Father, keep going. And whatsoever you ask, excuse me, and whatsoever you ask, I got to make sure I get this right. And whatever you ask in what? In my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Whatever you ask, the power of the greater works comes through prayer. By the Holy Spirit. Now the question is, how was Jesus able to do all of this greater works? Through the Father. He spent all night in prayer. Is that not true? This is Jesus. Jesus prayed. You might say, oh, pastor, why would Jesus have to pray? He's God. Yeah, but he was also human as well. And he prayed. He was dependent on his Father. He prayed all night. He also said in Luke 18:1, men ought to pray always and not to faint. You got to keep praying. You got to keep seeking God. You got to keep in prayer. Keep seeking. Keep calling upon the Lord. We've been preaching this for months. Keep calling on the name of the Lord. Keep asking, seeking, knocking. Keep that attitude of prayer. Pray without ceasing. You got to stay connected, just as Jesus was connected. That's important. He spent much time alone with his Father constantly. That's why Jesus said, "My house shall be called the house of prayer." That's why he said, "Ask, seek, and knock," all written in the present participle. Keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. The point is, if there's no connection, there's no power.
Oh,
goodness graciousness. Just as Jesus was connected to the Father, so it is you and I are connected to the Son. Did not Jesus say, "I am the vine and you are"? What happens if the branch is cut from the vine? No sap, no fluids, death. Dryness. How many branches are not truly connected to the vine? And some of them are in church. You got to be connected. You got to be in tune. You got to be abiding. If you abide in me and I abide in you, then you have to. That's what the abiding. You abide through seeking him. You abide through obedience. You abide through crying out. You abide through. Why did Jesus constantly talk about hungering and thirsting and praying and seeking? Because that's where the abiding and the connection takes place. Every great woman and man of God have been great, not because of who they are, but because of what God has done through them as they continue to seek him. That's the key. That's the connection. Jesus was connected to the Father. He was alone. And through that connection, he was able to do great works. If you've seen me, Philip, you've seen the Father. I'm connected. Prayer is not preparing you for the great thing. Prayer is the great thing. They that wait upon the Lord. I wore my tie today because I knew I was preaching this message. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall what? Mount up with wings as eagles. You're going to fly, man. You're going to be so, you know, you're praying, you're waiting on God. Man, you're just going to soar above all those circumstances. All these things that take place here in the valleys, you're going to be able to soar above them because greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. They won't be able to affect you. You're going to soar high. You shall run. And you shall walk. Because you're waiting on God. You're connected. Can't get away from that. Stop trying to find secret solutions to your problems and let me go see brother so-and-so. Maybe she's got a secret answer. Maybe if I go to the altar and this brother touches me on my head, I'll be set. Listen to me. If you don't have a private relationship with God, you can go to every altar and it won't last very long because God's concerned about what goes on in your private life. And if your private doesn't match your public, then you can fill in the blank. I got to close. I got to bring this to a close because I want to spend some time in prayer. They that wait upon the Lord. A few weeks ago, I talked about intercession, the womb of the Spirit. Remember that? God is working on behalf of those who wait upon him. Isaiah 64:4. And so they received this power as they prayed, as they waited. Yes, the Holy Spirit is the key. As we wait in him, he empowers. He wants to work in us so he can work through us. You know, brothers and sisters, some people have enough of Jesus to keep them from hell. But they don't have enough of Jesus to walk in victory. You like that? I'm going to say it again. Some people have enough of Jesus to keep them out of hell. In other words, you're saved. But don't have enough of Jesus to be able to walk in victory. Depressed all the time, discouraged, up and down. No victory. God wants to bring victory in your life. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew. Revival. Why do we pray for revival? Here it is. Renew me, Lord. Empower me with your Spirit. Stir it up, Lord. Stir it up. A passion for your name. Stir it up in my heart, Lord. Stir it up in my heart, Lord. We're speaking about the Spirit. Passion for your name. Stir it up, Holy. That's what we learned a couple of weeks ago when we talked about Haggai. George, very quickly, and I'm going to close, but very quickly, Haggai chapter 1, very quickly. Verse 14, George, please, very quickly. Got to see this, and we're going to close. Look at this. And the Lord stirred up. And the Lord stirred up. And the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel. He was the governor of Judah. And the spirit of Joshua, the son of he stirred up Zerubbabel. He stirred up Joshua. Then who was the high priest. And the spirit of the Lord stirred up the remnant of the people that they would work in the house of the Lord. The spirit of God stirred them up to do the work. From the governor to the priest to the people. So if that's true, what should we be praying if we're not building the house? And building the house doesn't mean physical building. Spiritual. Lord, stir me up, Lord. Holy Spirit, come and put a fire in me. Holy Spirit, I haven't been building your house. I've been complaining and murmuring most. I need you to stir my heart, Lord. I need you to stir my heart. I got to stop looking over here and going over there. Just stir my heart, Lord. Stir my heart, Lord. Stir my heart, Lord. That's what I got to be. Holy Spirit, come and stir it up. There's people that need to be saved, Lord. You've placed me in places, Lord, that I know you've placed me in. I've been blind, Lord. Stir me up. I'm at work and I see my workmates as walking trees. Stir me up. Yes. I'm in my home and I have a family and it just seems so idle. Stir me up. God wants to stir his people. He wants to stir the Joshuas, the priests, and he wants to stir the officials, the politicians as well, the governors. He wants to stir up the church. He wants to stir you up. He wants to stir me up. For what reason? To make a difference in this world. For what reason? To do what Jesus did, to come and seek and save the lost. Stir me up, Lord. Give me a passion for the lost. When was the last time you wept for a soul? When was the last time you cried out, God, please save this person? When was the last time you cared enough for somebody that you didn't worry about your needs, but you really cared about somebody else? Stir it up, Lord. Stir it up, Lord. Been praying a lot for revival, and I want to close with this. I gave you some statistics, and I told you 76 churches in our movement in this western district of 324 churches reported zero conversions in 1 year. 140 churches reported zero water baptisms in a year. Decline in attendance, thousands are declining in the last few years. 163 churches respond zero to Holy Spirit infillings. Latest statistics that were given to me by our General Superintendent of the Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada. People aren't getting saved like before, baptized in the Spirit like before. People hardly getting baptized in water anymore. We're declining, folks. Don't listen to what people are trying to, all these prophets that are telling you how great everything is. Let me tell you something now. Things are great. God is good. But I'll tell you something. We need a revival. If we really believe that we represent the early church, we have been misguided. We need a revival, folks. I just gave you the statistics. People aren't getting saved like they used to. People aren't getting delivered like they used to. Numbers are declining. Giving is declining. These are facts I'm giving you. Why? Because the church has lost its fire or losing its fire. People aren't getting saved anymore because we don't have burdens for the lost anymore. The Holy Spirit has stagnated. There's no stirring. Lord, stir me up, God. Give me eyes to see the way you want me to see, Lord. I'd like us to stand, please. Consuming fire. If you must go, well, we're really early today. This is great. 20 to 1. Not bad. Someone's praying for me. I know that. That's okay. I don't want to hear any amens right now. Maybe later, but not now. I want every head bowed just for a moment. It's very important, please. Very important. You know, arguably, this could be the most important message that we can hear as far as what God wants us to do, that you'll ever hear. Not because it's such a great message. There's nothing great about this message. But because the message is true, that's why. The message is true. It's as simple as that. I want to ask a question to Logos and to our visitors. We're so glad you're here. We really are. I pray every day that God continues to draw people. That God opens hearts, draws us to his presence. Every single day I pray that this church will be a hospital for the brokenhearted. That this church will be a watering hole for the thirsty. That this church would be a table for the hungry. Every single day. And not just for a few minutes. Trust me on that one. I want God to be glorified in his house, but I want God to be glorified through your life, in my life, at work, at home, at play, that Jesus would be seen in us, that we would fulfill the great commission to touch people for his glory. I want to ask a question today. How many would say, Pastor Dino, I really need the Holy Spirit to stir me up again because I don't seem to have that burden for the lost anymore. I haven't won someone to Christ in so long. It's been dry. I want to be used. I want God to open my eyes. I want the paraclete of God to come. I want your power to come in my heart. I want this venema you're talking about. I want God to stir me as he stirred the people of Israel to build his house. Unless you stir me, Lord, I cannot come. Every head bowed. Let me say something. If you really are praying, want to pray like, if you really want to experience what I just said, then get ready, because it's going to change your life. God is a God who answers prayer. And if you're serious about this, if you really want God to use you, if you want God to stir you up, if you want God to lead you, because this is his will. There's no doubt, hesitation, that this is the will of God, that none should perish. That God wants to use you and me to make a difference in this community. There's no doubt that that's the mission of the church. You don't need a prophetic word. This is the word. A sure word of prophecy. We have something more. The word of God. And the word of God is saying, this is my will. To reach out. To seek and save. My will that Logos reaches out. My will that you make a difference in this will. That you be the light. So Holy Spirit, just come now. Holy Spirit, I pray for those who will respond, that you'll begin to stir their hearts even now. Those, Lord, that you're speaking to as they're standing, those that you are speaking, even conviction, I pray for conviction to rise up, for spiritual tepidness and lethargy to leave. I pray that there'd be a fire come now, Lord, a fire to burn in the hearts. Stir it up. Stir it. If God is speaking to you, friend, I do not want you to hesitate or delay. I want you to come out of your pew. That's why I have you stand. I want you to come out of your pew. Don't worry about who's looking at you, because nobody's looking. You have all your eyes closed. And by the way, what does it matter if somebody's looking at you anyway? It doesn't matter. Just come out of your pew, and I want you to make your way to the front. We're going to have an upper room experience today. We're going to pray. Nobody's going to lay hands on you. You're going to pray. I'm going to pray. We're going to believe God that God's going to fill you right now. We're going to believe God that God's going to stir you up right now. We're going to believe God that God's going to empower you right now. We're going to believe God that God's going to do something powerful right now as you open your heart. We might even see healings take place. That's fine. That's fine. We want whatever God has for us. I believe that God wants to do great things through your life. And in my life.